Hey, horse people.
Of course, since I start filming, the wind picks up. Anyway, I wanted to talk about a couple of things from a couple comments. And again, my videos, my website, sometimes I get, you don't answer questions, or you create more questions than answers. It's because I want you to think. I want you to learn the process. I want you to understand that working with horses isn't an event or isn't a right or wrong answer, or there isn't one way. Working with horses is a process, and it's a give and take. So I want to discuss a little bit. The boys are out there just chilling out under the shade. I've got them in the dyke pasture there, if you can tell. I've got the driveway fenced off there so they can stop eating grass all day. Got some water out there, and then they go down to the trees and just chill out. So with them chilling out down there in the driveway, you can, again, you can see how important it is that horses aren't alone. These guys are out here for, I try to keep them out there for at least 8 hours during the day, during the hot of the day, when I don't want them eating that rich, high-sugared, carb grass with the heat heating it up. So they're standing head to toe, using each other's tails to help with the flies. But they're buddies. They're hanging out all day. They have, you know, people want to keep a horse locked up or something, so they got a horse next to them. It's just not the same. These guys spend 22 hours a day awake, and even when they're not awake, one of them sleeps and the other one watches out for the other one. So it's really a partnership, and it's really important, and I stress this a lot. Horses are not meant to be kept alone. Don't keep your horse alone. The wind changed, so kind of it's blowing directly at me right now, so it's probably going right in the microphone. Let me get some venting out to some knucklehead. When I mention something about idiots emailing me and writing me and doing something stupid and I complain about it, I always get four or five people that want to write me and think I'm talking about them. So they always want to write me and go, I know you were talking about me when you said blah, 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 blah. Look, you freaking crazy people. I don't remember who the hell I'm talking about. I get so damn many emails and it's so much for me to cover it. I usually get 100 different complaints before I cover a subject. So if you think you're that important, I had some guy when I talked about the microphone and putting foam. I've probably had 50 people tell me that if I put a piece of foam over the microphone, it'll keep it quiet. Well, in one of my last videos, I did something, and I had some guy all butthurt calling me, I knew you were talking about me, and you shouldn't be so arrogant. That's my crazy whining guy voice for all the women that want to complain that, you always make fun of women when you do your voice. Okay, I'm making fun of a guy now. I knew you were talking about me when you said put the foam on a microphone, and I was just trying to help you, and you need to be careful about being so arrogant just because you're popular. It ain't about arrogance, it's about dealing with dummies all the time. Shit, I just don't want to hear it. I don't care. So this guy wants to email me all butthurt. So I tell him, shut the hell up. Get off my channel. I ain't got time for your whining ass taking shit personal just because you got your feelings hurt because you were one of the 50 people that told me to put foam over the microphone and it would stop the wind. So now when I mention it, you think I'm talking about you because you're so important in my life that I got nothing else better to do than out of 1,000 emails that I get to remember your special tip about foam. Get over yourself, you big knucklehead. Freaking crazy people. Anyway, back to horses. Had to get that off my chest. When you're dealing, it's so important for horses to have buddies out there. You gotta let them have their friends. They spend so much time. 24 hours a day. We just don't have the time. We don't use our horses enough. We don't work with them enough. We just don't have the time between making a living, going to work, and all the other stuff to spend all this time with our horses. So don't, when you think, well, I go out and visit my horse, I get these other people that write me. Rick, you say that keeping a horse locked up, but I go out 3 times a day and see my horse. That ain't nothing. A horse has got the 8 hours or 10 hours that you sleep. They got all day by themselves. Just because you come out three, that ain't nothing. Horses spend all day by themselves, it's mind-numbing. It takes out their soul. It takes their horse out of them. They need to be able to have a friend. They need to be able to have a buddy. Buddy needs to be able to bite Mr. T and be a pain in the butt. Mr. T needs to be able to correct him and tell him to knock it off. They need to be friends. They need to chew on each other. They need to push each other. They need to get in each other's way. They need to step on each other. They need that mental stimulation. In the wild, that's what they would do. Horses were never, ever meant to be caged. Period. There's a saying about there's nothing so sad as a robin in a cage or something. Nothing. God, what is that saying? Somebody will probably remember it. The heavens are so sad from the sight of a red robin in a cage or something to that effect. Birds aren't meant to be caged up no more than horses are meant to be fenced up. And it's not good. So let your horse be friends. But the purpose that I wanted to cover here is I wanted to talk about the Stockholm Syndrome. And the Stockholm Syndrome, and again, my videos are to get you to think, look, research, learn, and apply things that horses teach us to life to make you more of a critical thinker, to make you more of an individual, to make you not so dependent on me, other trainers, your shows, your instructors, your judges. Forget about all these other people. Concentrate on you and your horse and make yourself better and your horse better. So the Stockholm Syndrome, some of you may know about it. In law enforcement, the Stockholm Syndrome is a big key that when we deal with crisis situations in a law enforcement situation, if you're taken as a hostage, when cops come in, they treat everybody like a bad guy. You don't say, oh, well, you've got a pink shirt on and you're the nice little teller behind the window. So when I come in and I'm looking for a bad guy, I'm going to say, hi, Miss Teller, because I know you're a nice person. You would never hurt me. And then I'm just going to look for the mean guy with the mask and the gun. Because crooks will either dress like people, they'll change their attitude, and because of the thing called the Stockholm Syndrome. In Stockholm, there was a bank that was taken over. I think it was a bank. It was a long time ago when I studied this. But the Stockholm Syndrome has taught to cops that, hey, when somebody's taken hostage, when someone is being held against their will, when someone is programmed and locked into a certain situation, they end up depending on this their captor to provide food, to not kill them, to not hurt them, so they become nice, and then they start getting sympathetic with their captor. And then they start realizing that this person has some good points because they're stuck with them and they're spending time. And they become sympathetic to the person's cause and to the person. And when you're in a stressful situation, in a life-changing situation, if somebody saves you, you get close to that person. There's a bond. It happens in the military, in war, brothers. Guys who fight with guys will end up having them call them brothers because they're so close, because they've saved each other's life. They've depended on each other. And cops do the same thing. When you call for help and other blue uniforms come and save you, there's this bond that develops because they just saved you from getting killed. So you tend to appreciate and like them. It's kind of normal. And so the Stockholm Syndrome is a syndrome that happens to people who are held captive or gets caught in a situation where they end up getting sympathetic. They stop thinking reasonable. So what happened in this bank robbery is there were women that ended up marrying the bank robbers and getting so close and connected to them and developing such a bond in this short circumstance of being held captive that they became this tight group and this bond that they felt was love, etc. So it stops rational thinking and it gets you into an emotional thinking. What does that have to do with horses, Rick? Why are you talking about cop crap? Because it does have to do with horses. It has to do with everyday life. Women who are in an abusive relationship get some sort of the Stockholm Syndrome. They start depending on the person that's abusing them as the provider. They start accepting things they wouldn't accept. They start feeling this need to be with this person who can provide them release. Children who are abused get what's called a kind of different note of a Stockholm Syndrome to where... Mr. T's moving off here. Because they get close. An abusive, if one of the parents is abusing a child, the child will normally be closer and more pleasing to the abusive parent. So if you're not aware of this thing, when you're investigating a child abuse, you will end up saying, well, the kid really likes dad, so dad must not be the abuser. It's actually the opposite. he likes the abuser because he knows the abuser can hurt him and can cause him pain, so he doesn't want to get on his bad side, so he ends up being closer and kissing the abuser's butt. Well, that could be misconstrued. What happens with horses is people get caught up into this Stockholm syndrome where they depend on their trainer. Their trainer can keep them safe. Therefore, I have to kiss my trainer's butt. Therefore, I have to like my trainer. Therefore, I get so dependent on my trainer that whatever the trainer tells me, even though it's irrational, that I need a bigger bit to cause more pain, that I need to whip my horse, that I need to do stupid things, because I depend on this trainer and I'm locked in this Stockholm syndrome because I depend on him, that I end up doing things that really are against my gut, that really I probably wouldn't do unless I was in this fearful emotional state. So don't get caught up in a Stockholm syndrome when you're either looking for trainers, when you're working with trainers, when you have somebody at the barn, these barn witches and barn managers that know everything about horses and have all these rules because they've been around horse their whole life, and because you're new or you're locked into that situation and you have no choice, you have no other place to keep your horse, you're new to the horse world, you have nobody to depend on, so you have to go to anybody that will help you. Anybody that will keep you safe. Anybody that can give you information that may prevent you from getting hurt. That's the Stockholm syndrome. That's how it relates. Hopefully there's a little light that went on. Ding, ding, ding. There's a little light that went on and went, oh, that's how it connects. That's true. Because when new people get into horses, they're scared. Horses are big. They're not as young. They're getting into horses for the first time. They're getting into it after a long break. They're not as good in shape. A lot of older horse people, they get back into horses, they aren't as good in shape. They're more worried about getting hurt. That they don't heal as quick. All these fears make you dependent on other people to keep you safe. That's a bad thing to get into. It's not good when you get into it with your captor. It's not good when you get into it with an abuser. And it's not good when you get into it with somebody trying to make money and take advantage of your lack of knowledge, of your lack of understanding of horses and horsemanship. So fear, emotion, all those things start taking place and you start depending and getting fearful, like, I can't say no, or I don't have a mind, or the person must be right, or they wouldn't tell me that, so I gotta listen. All those things are not good, people. You buy into things that you wouldn't normally buy into. And again, I want people to think, I want you to understand your horse, I want you not to have to depend on me or anybody else, and I want a horse to get a better life. And horses get better lives when their owners understand them. They realize that it's not a secret, it's not a horse whispering event, it's not some special thing that you need to pay somebody $12,000 to teach you. You don't have to go through lessons and this abusive relationship with trainers that tell you, well, you can either listen to me or you can get hurt, or you can pay me $600 a month and I'll give your horse 30 days and I'll fix all your problems, or I'll do this or I'll do that, making all these crazy promises. And because you feel you have no choice, because you feel afraid, because you feel trapped, because you feel like you don't really have the ability to say no, because if you say no, then you're stuck with this bad situation that you don't know how to deal with. That's the Stockholm syndrome of horses. Don't get caught up in it. I think it happens not only with trainers, but I think it happens with horses. Horses will put you in a Stockholm syndrome. You get a horse that was abused. Oh, he was abused, and I can't ever tell him no because he'll hate me. Well, then the horse starts becoming the abuser. The horse starts treating you bad. He starts pushing you. He starts treating you with no respect. He starts not thinking that you're the leader, because you're not, because you're scared and you want to make everything better and you don't want to hurt your relationship and you don't want to get hurt, and I don't want the horse to hurt me, so if I'm nice to him, he won't hurt me. That's the Stockholm syndrome with a horsey. Don't be a victim of an abused horse, of an abusive trainer, of a barn witch, of a barn manager, of somebody that tells you, you need to listen to me or you're going to get hurt. Because that's what a horse tells you. When you're scared and running around and not really wanting to correct a horse or tell a horse no, guess what? You're trying not to get hurt. You're trying to avoid the fact that you don't know and you're scared and you're looking for the easy answer. Well, believe me, not taking the time to understand a horse and to realize that the message you're sending really hurts you and a horse and teaches a horse bad lessons, that's what will get you in trouble. That's what will get you in a bad situation. Remember, Stockholm Syndrome, look it up, read about it. It applies to a lot of things. Don't get caught up in it. We'll end that theorem in 15 minutes. Buddy, Mr. T, you're good boys.